Just the ricochet effect. Ricochet effect, like ricochet effect. Yeah. We having conversation with no moderation. Love to the communities, the ricochet effect. Having conversation with no moderation. Love to the communities, the ricochet effect. Having conversation with no moderation.
Hi, this is Renee Cobb, and
I'm Dr. Obini El Amin, and we are with the Ricochet Effect.
The WUKY 2024 Women of Distinction kicks off in the month of March for Women's History Month. We have 13 nominees, 4 committee members from staff and the WUKY cab, and WUKY newsroom engagement. All women will be recognized on WUKY news programming. However, 4 women are selected to be highlighted in each week of March and at a culminating program to be held at WUKY Studios on March 28, 2024 at 6 p.m. Karyn Czar is an award-winning news reporter for WUKY. Karyn has also received a bone marrow transplant as part of her treatment for multiple myeloma. Karyn has shared details of her story, and she has talked about the mental and emotional challenges, too often obscured by the physical recovery process. She shares her story in hopes of ending the stigma associated with talking openly about mental health issues.
Greetings, all. This is Dr. Obini El Amin with the Ricochet Effect, and I am so excited. I am in the studio with Karyn Czar. You know her very well because she is an award-winning journalist here at WUKY, and she is one of our nominees for the Women of Distinction. And the Women of Distinction are truly an amazing group. There were 13 nominees, and Karyn is certainly one of those, as well as she should be, because she is a titan in the journalist and media community. How are you doing today, Karyn?
I am great. Thank you so much.
It is wonderful to have you here in the studio on the other side of the room instead of actually being the interviewer. So,
and you make really me great. Sound so cool.
Oh, you are cool. You're more than amazing. So as a Woman of Distinction nominee, what does that title mean to you? Because you have received so many awards over the years in media, but what does being a woman of distinction mean to you?
This is the first time I've ever been acknowledged for anything like this. You know, a woman of the year, a woman of distinction, a woman of the community. And I was so flattered, but at the same time, I felt a little bit shy because I always think of myself as seeking out my next mentor and my next person to take me to the next direction, that I don't see myself in that way. And so I'm just incredibly flattered and honored.
Oh, well, you know what? It is our honor to welcome you into such a tribe of amazing professionals. So can you tell us about a significant challenge you faced in your career or personal life and how you overcame it?
Actually, the biggest would be just in the last 18 months. For those of you who have been listening on the air at WUKY, I was diagnosed with multiple myeloma. I started to get sick. It was actually 2 years ago to this date that I just wasn't feeling right. Things were off. I kept going to the doctor. I first landed in the emergency room. Because I thought I was my migraines were so bad. I thought I had had a stroke. The pain was so bad. And it went away, and they couldn't really find anything, but the fatigue was still there. I was having memory loss, and nobody could really figure anything out. And luckily, my general practitioner was incredible, and she knows me really well. She knows I'm not someone who is constantly in the doctor's office for every little thing. And in fact, I probably don't even go when I should. So she knew I was very serious about something being wrong. And she just said, you know what? I'm sure maybe it's just a vitamin, which we did find out my B12 had been depleted. And so she said, maybe that's it. And or you're having some post-COVID symptoms and you'll bounce back. But I would feel better if we just went through a checklist of things so we could say, no, you're fine on that. And go down the list. She said, it'll make me feel better. It'll make you feel better. Well, as we started going down the list, she found little things wrong here and there, got me into some specialists. And if she had not done that, we probably wouldn't have known for a couple of years that I had cancer.
Mm. And that's the beauty of the she. Mm-hmm. Because I heard you say she many times there.
She.
So the power of women, taking care of women and even in healthcare. So actually that's a powerful, powerful story of women supporting women.
And actually, there were a couple male doctors who said, well, you're a woman of a certain age. And it could have been that. It could have just been I'm starting menopause. There was one who said, well, I think you're fine. I think you're just anxious. Which, again, even if it was just anxiety, that is a real health issue. So a lot of the stories that I've been doing over the last year and a half are just do not let someone gaslight you as a woman, which happens a lot in medicine and in healthcare. So if it had not been for her, she is my hero.
Yeah, absolutely. And she's my shero too, because I know that this place here, we certainly shine because of you being here at WUKY. So, well, what inspired you to pursue your current career path or advocacy work?
It was a complete accident. I started in radio right out of college, but I was a DJ. I spun records and did the whole thing, interviewed music artists. And,
you like chicka-chicka.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I did the whole thing. Oh, yeah. Classic rock, you know, alternative, you name it. I did it and produced commercials and that kind of thing. And I left the business for a couple of years because my parents had gotten sick. And so I was taking care of them, working some part-time jobs, and so I could be home more. And when they passed, I went to my old boss and was like, you know, I don't know what direction I want to go now. I just feel like I'm flailing and I just need to be back in radio, even if it's part time, to kind of get my head back into something I'm passionate about while I figure out my next move. And he said, you know, we have an opening in news. Would you be interested? And I said, well, I've never done it, but I'll give it a try. And he said, I've worked with you. You will learn it. You'll be great. And I fell in love. It was such a God wink thing and never looked back. And I had planned on moving to New York or LA to do theater and perform and do voiceover work. And I remember sitting in the studio one day thinking, I never thought I would find something I loved as much as performing on stage. And this is it. And not that news is performing by any means. That's not what I'm saying. But
yes,
I just,
understood.
The interaction of getting to interview people and meet all these great people and share their stories just totally, just,
we,
it's my
we
passion.
Don't know how you do it, because you get interviews with people that take others a year to get an interview with, but somehow people are like, oh, Karyn Czar? Oh, yeah, absolutely. We'll talk to her. So then how do you define success and how do you strive to achieve it in your endeavors?
To me, success has never been about money. And for those of you who've worked in businesses like public radio and a lot of journalists, unless you're very high profile, we're not in this to get rich. That's not what drives us. I want to be happy. I want to enjoy coming into work every day. I know so many people's parents or mentors have told them the same thing. If you do something you love, you'll never work a day in your life. And true,
right,
we
right.
We have to eat. You have to make a paycheck.
Yes.
But to me, I am more driven if somebody tells me I did a great job. I want to work harder and work more. I care that somebody heard a story and said, oh, my gosh, that changed my life. I went and got a mammogram because of that interview you did with the lieutenant
Absolutely.
Governor. And this actually happened, too. I was hiding in my closet because I heard you on the air when the tornado was coming, and I didn't know, and half of my house is gone.
Oh, my goodness.
And that happened with the Masterson Station tornadoes 15 years ago, however long
right,
ago that
right.
was. That's what drives me, making a difference in people's lives. That's what I'm passionate about.
Well, you've won a number of awards over the years. In fact, I was at the Kentucky Broadcast Association conference, and you kind of swept the field. So what are some of the awards that you've won in the past and some of the associations and some of the critical awards that are given in media in this category?
Thank you for being there, by the way, because that actually happened while I was getting my bone marrow transplant.
Oh, I'm happy to represent you anytime. It was an honor.
Oh, thank you. I was so honored that you were there for me. And I know several people from the station were there to cheer us all on. Kentucky Broadcasters Association. I've won, oh my gosh, Reporter of the Year. See, this is when I feel weird because it's just, I don't know.
But that's what this is about, is us celebrating you. You know, you shouldn't feel weird. And you put it out there every single day. You bring the power, the energy, so that we can be our best selves. Mm-hmm. And so it's about also re-energizing you so that you can continue to be the best version of yourself.
Thank you. I've won Reporter of the Year in Kentucky, for the state of Kentucky, probably about between 12 and 15 times in my career.
Oh, my. Wow.
But I've been doing this for a long time. I've been doing it for quite a while. Several, like, spot news story wins or best political reporter, things like that. I think the biggest feather in the cap has been the Edward R. Murrows. I'm so proud of those, because not that the Kentucky Broadcaster isn't as mean as much, because we're chosen by people within our industry for the entire state. But what's so interesting about the Murrows is it's region wide. So we're competing against several other states, and then it goes to nationals. Then you're competing against the entire country. So it's always interesting to see the perception from other parts of the country about our work. So those have meant a lot. And, you know, just Edward R. Murrow is just such a trailblazer in our field. To win an award named after him just means a lot.
Yeah, I mean, WUKY is on the move. I mean, we do so many fantastic things here. And although we have a small staff, mm-hmm. we are mighty. I mean, you would not know that the 20, 30 people that we have on staff, but yet we operate just as if we were one of the big dogs in the industry, don't we? So as a woman in your field, what do you see as the most pressing issues or barriers for women's advancement, and how do you work to address them?
I think that what I mentioned earlier, gaslighting of women, is still prominent, unfortunately, in a lot of industries, in most industries. I just dealt with it within the medical field.
Yes.
I think that we need to always advocate for ourselves. And I think as women, we need to support one another.
Absolutely.
Instead of tearing each other down. You see it on social media all the time. And we need to lift each other up. We need to lift each other up within our workplace. We need to support each other. We need to stand up for each other. Over the years, and again, it's gotten so much better than when I first started. I was only one of two women at the radio station I started at as far as being on the air. And it was surrounded by men. And I will never forget this. I was told within the first month, there were just some jokes and some things being said that were so inappropriate nowadays. Back then, I remember being told by a male manager, if you want to stay in this business, you got to play like one of the boys. So basically, you know, suck it up. And if somebody says something inappropriate or does something inappropriate, it's just part of the business.
It happens.
It very much happens. And, you know, women sometimes aren't taken seriously or listened to. And we need to make sure if someone is going through something and does not have the support, we need to stand by our sisters.
Yes,
and
we do.
Hold them high and back them.
Well, and speaking of which, so we here at WUKY have a woosah room. Everyone do that with me. Woosah. And so we have a woosah room. So how has that room impacted your well-being in the workplace?
I love the room. First of all, there's a flower in there and sometimes snacks, so I enjoy it very much. It's just so peaceful and calming, and there's a little chair in there that you can, like, spread out to take a nap, which is so great for me. Not that we're all here taking naps. That's not what I'm saying.
Right.
But when I was going through chemo so extensively, it was a place that I could go and just rest for a little bit so that I could work through the rest of the day without feeling guilty about it. It was always open, and it's almost like you walk in that room and you feel like you've just stepped into the spa.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just the weight is lifted. It's private, and you can just collect your thoughts and sit in quiet, beautiful, light-colored room. As far as the lighting, it's just mm-hmm. dim and just relaxing.
Yes. Well, thank you for that, because in part, we wanted to ensure that we had a space here for you. I mean, here at WUKY, we boast our
incredible diversity and inclusion strategy. And we want to make sure that all staff and anyone who walks into the building is welcomed and that they feel safe upon entering the space. So everything that we do here is for you, for us.
Thank you.
So who are some women that have influenced or mentored you throughout your journey, and what lessons have you learned from them?
Now, a few that actually I've never met, but just because this is a business where you get to watch people growing up. Of course, Barbara Walters. Come on.
Absolutely.
I mean, she's so great. And I loved the probably, I want to say, Oprah Winfrey, too. I mean, there's so many big ones that I've watched. But several cycles of The View, they would have, there were moments where I felt like they had great chemistry and just to get to watch them work. But on a personal level, in my own life, it's actually somebody not in radio has been my biggest mentor, and her name is Vivian Snipes. She used to be one of the artistic directors at Lexington Children's Theater, and actually really took them to the level that they are at now. And she's retired. Yeah, she's retired now, but she and her husband worked there for several decades, and I actually got to work with her. I auditioned for her for a play my senior year of college. I hadn't graduated yet. And it was like, I was so nervous because it was my first professional audition. And I always felt like I was an okay actress, but I never felt like I was very good. You know, I enjoyed it and I loved it, but I was okay. She pulled me aside and said things about my audition that I didn't even think of, like, I love that you picked up that basket, and I love that you did this, and you're just so good. She was the first person who told me I was very good. And I don't think she would know to this day how much that meant to me and how much that changed the trajectory of my confidence, because I never had anyone tell me I was good at it.
Yeah, so, we need that. We need that level of support and people to just give us that attagirl and boost us, right?
And so
that's remarkable that you had someone like that that really changed, like you said, the trajectory of your path.
And I think, too, it's not necessarily, and you may have dealt with this in your own life, it's not necessarily that you weren't what other people saw that you were, but no one ever said it. So you just think, eh.
Yeah, there's that meme that you want other women that when you are not in that room to say your name.
Mm-hmm.
And we need that. And then for us at Project Ricochet and in the community, it's that when we are supporting one another, that is when some of the social ills, the social determinant of health issues, that's when they go on the decline. So imagine a society where we're supporting each other, regardless if we are a male or a female identifying physician, really listening to the patient, or as one colleague to another, highlighting and elevating, and again, speaking about our other female colleagues when they're not in the room, or advocating for them when it comes to a promotion or an award, the difference that that will make in one's career, but also for them personally. I just don't think that we can say enough about the power of supporting one another in that regard.
Don't you think also it's a matter of knowing when to say you were wrong and you still have room to grow yourself? And I say that because for those of you who have not met me, I am white. DeBron Thomas here at our station is like my work baby brother. He's one of my dearest friends. And, you know, I've always thought I'm an ally. I want to be a good ally.
Yes.
But, you know, he teaches me all the time. There are things that you don't know until you don't know them.
Right.
And you have to be able to acknowledge, I'm sorry, I did not realize this thing, and I want to do better. And that's okay, because you can't be a better person if you're not willing to say, I made a mistake.
Right. Absolutely. But you wouldn't be here at this level in your career if you weren't that kind of person, because I really think that as a woman of distinction, you're also a leader in the community and in the industry, but you're also leading yourself. And part of being a leader means that you have to take an assessment almost
I'm feeling these days in the moments mm-hmm. at times, but certainly you have to take an assessment of how you can do better and be better by the people that you serve and that you work with and even live with.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
So how do you balance your professional commitments with your personal life and other interests?
I'm not really the best at balancing that, I have to admit, because I love my job so much. I put in probably more than I should. The one upside of getting cancer, if there is a silver lining, is that it really forced me to say, girl, you have to slow down mm-hmm. and it's okay. And coming back to work, it was hard because I don't have the energy that I did before. It was interesting because when I covered the Western Kentucky tornadoes, it was 12, 14 hour days, 7 days a week for a couple of weeks covering everything. And then, you know, soon after that, it was the Eastern Kentucky floods. And I could tell a huge shift in my body and my energy. And this was right before I was diagnosed. We just knew something was off. And it was so hard to accept that. And it's okay. I had to realize it is okay. You're not going to be able to go like the Energizer Bunny 24/7. I'm also not 20 years old anymore by any stretch of the imagination. So coming back after being in quarantine for 3 months and really pretty much bedridden, accepting the fact that there are days where I'm going to get in 2 or 3 hours and I might have to go take a nap. But you know what? Just this week, I was back in Eastern Kentucky and I worked a 12-hour day with the drive and had the time of my life. I mean, I hate what I was there for,
yes, yes.
But it was actually very joyous because a lot of families were getting ready to move into the high ground communities. And I'm like, I was here when these people were at their worst.
Yes.
And I get to be here to celebrate this incredible day for them. And that's just it's what makes me tick.
Oh, absolutely. But when you think of cancer, my mm-hmm. father used to always call it the big C. So he transitioned as a result of chronic lymphoma.
I'm so sorry.
Cancer. Yes, it was terrible and still is. But so thank you for that. But he would call it the big C. And he had similar thoughts in terms of the energy level and then just not being there. And it's like the rest of the world is swirling around and moving at a pace. And you are in slow motion is how he described it. And I think that this is why people here at WUKY and in the community respect you so much, is because somehow, somewhere as a woman of distinction, that you find the energy to be here for us, even at the peril of yourself. And I really do think that that's what makes a person distinct, is that they do and go the extra mile. And you do that for us every single day, and you do it well.
Thank you.
In what ways do you give back to your community or support other women in their pursuits?
I have had a lot of interns come through who I've gotten to work with over the years, and they are now out working across the country. And I'm so proud of each and every one of them. One of them, actually, we were talking about Kentucky Broadcasters Association a little while ago. She won second best anchor in the state a couple years ago. And I was actually nominated as well. And it was so sweet because she sent me this email going, oh, I have to go up against you. I'm not going to win. I said, are you kidding? I want you to beat me. I want you to beat me. And she did. And I sent her an email immediately. It's like, I'm so proud of you. And that's what I was talking about. It's like, yes, everyone's a little bit competitive, but we need to just cheer for each other. I mean,
that's right. But I mean, you won the award. You've won it several times, or you've won similar awards. So it's like when you see someone with talent, that could be the one award that gets them to the Emmys.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Is there an Emmys in public media?
There should be, darn it, because they're pretty. I think you and I should just make them and bedazzle them. We're just going to put them on our desks.
We're innovating around here, so
we feel we earned it. Darn it! Those Emmys are pretty. I know. I want to do something in TV just because I want that pretty trophy. I hate to say it because I know it's not about prizes, but I work a lot with kids in the community. I do a lot of performing still as my hobby, and Children's Theater is an organization that I've done a lot of shows with. The Lex, Lexington Theater Company here in town. I had a call back with them. I might be performing with them this summer. And I get to work with so many incredible people in the community and around the country who've come in for that. And I love it so much. And it's a moment where we do so many difficult, hard stories. When you're on stage and you're developing a character, you can kind of step away from all that. It's kind of like the room we talked about here at the station. Being on stage would also be equivalent to that for me as far as a...
Yes.
So getting to work with kids...
Just exhaling.
Yes, exactly. And I volunteer a lot at the School for Creative and Performing Arts.
Wow, you're busy. How do you manage it all?
I take a break every now and then. And of course, where I've not been feeling well, I have been, on sabbatical a little bit. But I head back to Woodford County. Actually, this semester, I'll be costuming a show for them. And just doing a lot of things with theater on the side is kind of how I give back, because it's my other passion.
Well, yeah. And it truly speaks to you didn't accomplish all of this stuff in 1 month. I mean, this is a lifetime of service. Truly adding to what it means to be a woman of distinction. So what advice would you give to other women aspiring to make a difference in their respective fields or communities?
Do something you love. Do it with all of your heart, and you will love every minute of every day, truly. And what we've been saying this entire program, love each other. Love the people you are working alongside and care for them. And they will in turn care for you. There's nothing worse than working alongside, be it in a volunteer situation, in your working environment, or even in your home life. If you're butting heads all the time, or you're competing and trying to one-up each other, it just makes for such a miserable environment. But if you're there to lift each other up and love each other and support each other and just constantly tell those around you how great they are, I'm smiling right now just thinking about it. It's like, I'm like, oh, who can I go tell today that they did something great? Like, I love it. I love calling somebody or them calling me and saying, hey, what can I do to make your day amazing? Mm-hmm. It will completely change your perspective on a daily basis. And don't get me wrong, I have bad days. There are days when I don't feel good, especially with what I'm going through with my health. But you just can't let it drag you down. By the same token, it is okay to have a bad day. It is okay to have a great cry.
Yes.
But help each other pull out of that. And don't sit in it. Because if you sit in it too long, it'll drag you down.
Yeah. And... So, Project Ricochet, we sponsor a program also with WUKY. So, the Healthy Wife Initiative is how we got to the Women of Distinction event and the nominations and awards ceremonies that we will have here on March 28th. And, so Dr. Wells from Indiana Wesleyan, she is a professor there in their social work department. But she also is a coach.
Mm-hmm.
And so she was just talking about how 80 to 90% of the words and the messages that we give ourselves in terms of the self-talk, up to 90% of it is negative.
Mm-hmm.
And I sat there in that stew and I just really had to think, am I doing this to myself?
Mm-hmm.
Am I doing this to myself? So when you say that, like, you give and shower people with love and flowers and words of affirmation, it's like, what are we doing for ourselves in terms of that self-affirmation, those self-affirming words that then lead to feelings and then actions? So I think that that's a really important point, is that women go through so much and people of color go through so much already. Mm-hmm. I mean, in terms of the negative self-talk. So whether it's the reality or not, in so many cases, before you even win or even can get to a place of winning, you've already lost. But you've done that to yourself because of, again, all those negative messages. So, again, it's truly important. And I applaud you for recognizing that we need to do that. You're like, you do it. I mean, you are always affirming and always such a body of light. I walk into WKYR to the newsroom, and it's like if Karyn is there, you just know the whole place is lit up. So thank you for that.
Oh, thank you for all that you do. And, you know, you just brought up a good point, too. We also need to advocate for ourselves, stand up for ourselves. And I can't tell you how many meetings I've been at, especially in my early days, where I'm sorry, men, I'm not trying to man bash or anything, but it has happened. Men have taken credit for my idea or another woman sitting in the room's idea. And, you know, when I was younger, it's like, you're not supposed to speak up and you're not supposed to. No more. I'm not like that anymore.
Oh, I know
it's like,
that's
no,
right.
that was not your idea. And that was her idea. And, you know, so really stand up for yourself. It's okay.
Yeah.
It is okay. And it's completely unfair for women to be told, oh, you're being difficult or you're being whatever the word you want to attach to that. But if a man does that, it's like, oh, he's a strong leader, you know?
I do.
Yeah, be a strong leader and it is okay.
Yeah, I've rarely ever slammed up against that wall because I was raised by a single parent father. And he always gave his girls the leadership mantra, like, go out there and roar. While that may be somewhat daunting for others, it just doesn't even hit the Richter scale over here, women.
Well, that's the one thing that I've learned so much from you, and I'm so glad you've been singing my praises. I'm so glad you're at our station, because since the moment you came into this building, you really set the tone of just really embracing being a woman and embracing our ideas and feeling like we have just as much right to have a seat at this table as anybody else.
Oh, absolutely. So with that being said, how do you envision using your platform or influence to create positive change for women and girls in the future?
Because I think of what I've been through in the last year, I really want to focus on making sure I am there for any woman who contacts me, and many already have, who are going through health issues, who have been through something similar as me. They were told, this is all in your head, or you're fine, or we can't find anything, so we're giving up. I don't want people to give up on their health. I was talking about the interview I did earlier with Lieutenant Governor Jacqueline Coleman, who just went through her own cancer scare. Fortunately, it was not. But she went through a double mastectomy, and she shared that on the air, and she actually just sent a beautiful thank you that she appreciated that I did it while I was going through my own health crisis. And, you know, but that's part of it. I share my story. She shares her story. Someone already contacted me and said they heard her story on the air and they've scheduled their mammogram. That's what it's about. And I want to make sure that no one that comes in contact with me ever again says, I'm sick and nobody believes me. And I can't find anyone to believe me, because I'll tell you, I hear you, I see you, and I believe you.
Absolutely. And we should celebrate Lieutenant Governor Coleman, because she has also been recognized as a USA Today's Woman of the Year Kentucky honoree. So she is absolutely gobstopped, amazing, beautiful, so intelligent, so wise, and really making strides for the state of Kentucky. So we do celebrate her as well. So, hey, people.
She's amazing.
Karyn Czar, y'all. Give her a hand. Thank you so much for being on the Ricochet Effect. We really appreciate your time. We appreciate you for everything that you do for WUKY, the community, and yourself.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for having me.
Well, we've come to the close of another amazing podcast. I'd like to thank our listeners. I'd like to thank our guest. And as we say here at WUKY, we can't do it without our community. Our programming is distinctive because it provides development opportunities for community and economic empowerment. It's the Ricochet Effect, Ricochet Effect. We'll be right back.
effect. Ricochet effect.